We're gonna hear from Daniela Hoopencoffen. I did it. Who is a postdoc at NYU. Today she's gonna be telling us about data visualization. I think we're gonna hear a bit about the theory of data visualization and why some plots work and others don't. And then tomorrow she'll tell us about interpretability of machine learning models. But without further ado, I'll let Daniela get started.
All right. Hi, everyone. I know it's late in the day, so I have tried to put in a lot of kind of experimental bits where you get to like try stuff, so pay attention. Okay, so I'm a postdoc, I write papers, so I do data visualization, and when I started preparing this, I realized how interested I actually am in why some things work and why things don't. So instead of giving you rules for what you should do and what you shouldn't do, I'm going to give you the why of why we perceive certain things in a certain way and certain things in different ways, and I hope that will let you basically figure out by yourself why you need to do certain things in certain ways and other ways and other things in other ways. Okay, so I don't think I need to really tell you what data visualization is for, but let me do that anyway. So the whole idea of visualization is really for you to see things that would rather go unnoticed. For you when you do your data analysis, but also for your readers and the people you present to, for them to sort of, you know, figure out what it is in your data in a way that's easier to understand than just listening to words. So here's basically an example. This is a table of the GDP of various parts of the world, and there's lots of numbers in there. And sure, it's lots of numbers. They kind of like go up in this direction, but that's basically almost all they can tell from just reading those numbers. And as soon as you put that on some kind of figure, we've removed all of the numbers in the table, but suddenly you can actually see trends. You can see that Western Europe and the USA sort of keep going up together really sharply. You can see that India and Africa and Japan are sort of on this other track, and you can see that China had this big jump between 1973 and 2003. And that's all information you didn't really get just from reading the table. So the first thing I want you to take away from this is that visualization is really good at helping you see trends and see sort of groupings and stuff like that. And why that is, I'm going to come back in a minute. So what I want you to do is really think of visualization as a new set of languages you can use to communicate. And like any language, it has a sort of grammar, it has a sort of vocabulary, and that's what we're going to try to explore. But first, here's an example of how not to do visualization. This is like in the when I prepared this talk, I just typed worst visualizations ever into Google, and believe me, that was one of the most fun talk preparations I ever did. So please don't do this in your talk. And before we go on, I think I want to do an exercise with you. I want to know how much like you already know about data visualization, maybe instinctively because as scientists you look at a lot of figures, or maybe because you're at some formal exercise. So what I want you to do is just get together with your neighbors, and if you happen to be three in a row, then just like be three. If you're not,
they're already in their groups.
Yeah.
Right, but this is a different exercise.
Okay.
So you can also be in pairs of three or four. And then I want you to go to that folder. Let me do that right now. Oops. I hope you should all have access. And then there's a whole directory of figures. And each great group, just pick one of these. Actually, no, let's not put one of these at random. Let's just say in the groups as you are. And so we'll start with like figure one, figure two, figure three, figure four, figure five, and figure six. Okay? Does that work? Okay, what I want you to do for the next 5 minutes in your groups is is basically write down what you like about the figure and what you don't like about the figure, what you think works well and what don't works well. Can you do that? Is that reasonable? Okay. I'll give you 5 minutes and then we'll collect the results.
When you set the numbers, did you mean the in list or
no,
the number of courses?
The number at the end. There's two of you on the same figure as the
matter. Can I have an idea?
Is it a number?
Number.
I don't like how some of the colors are in different.
So this is the number of people, and so show you the demographics.
It's good. I mean, like, the one for us? It's good that it goes into the
It doesn't say that everywhere. That's the only way I can have so they can sort of label mode.
This is showing an action if
I think it should be percentage instead of number of
people.
But from the way that it looks like everything's just down.
What, 19?
because white people are down.
And all of a sudden,
this
stretch is much longer for the same decade.
Although, so the other thing is, it's possible that there's some flavor just here because it says purple. So my guess is that she found already.
This is her way up
the way you would describe on the graphic.
Well,
we don't have that.
Yeah, I guess.
Like, you can sort of see that it's just black.
Oh, there's no tiger code.
Like, this looks like it's twice as, like, this looks like twice as big as this, but there's so much. You can't see.
The bottom is the whole entire part, and then the top is the percentage of that number, and then the black part represents a percentage of the pie. Okay.
I don't want to interrupt. I think you're having like really fascinating discussions. But I would like to collect. Do you have some idea of what you like and dislike about the figure?
Yeah.
Okay. Then I would like to collect quickly some results. You had figure one. Did you pick this one or the one on?
The one on figure one.
Yeah.
This is the figure. What did you like and dislike about it?
I don't think we really liked anything
about it. The one thing that we liked was that like it went in order at least.
Okay.
Which implies that they should have done a bar graph
or a line plot.
It's a time series, right?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. It's like time is circular. But,
All right.
It took me like 30 seconds to figure out what this was even trying to plot.
Some of the colors look basically the same because of shading and optical illusion. But, like the three blue colors.
Right.
At least.
Yeah.
Also.
Appropriate time for theta. Colors.
It uses all the colors that it uses all the colors that are a problem for color blindness. It uses like red and green and dark shades right next to each other.
It's unnecessarily three dimensional. Yeah, and that creates like projection effects that just skewed your view of the data.
Right, I'm not sure I even write down everything for all groups.
Yeah.
But that's a good list. I so wish I couldn't find the data for it, but I so wish I'd found the actual data that made that.
Oh, right. Sorry, one other thing is there aren't actually numbers on there, so we don't actually know how many features there are.
Let me write that information on it. Okay.
Second plot.
This one. Did you use this one?
Okay.
What? I have to say for this, I only pulled plots from the internet that were done by professional organization who should like have graphic designers and really know better. But I specifically didn't take any astronomy plots because I didn't want to like shame any astronomers. So these people all should know better. Anyway, group two.
So we talked about a few different things.
Okay.
I think the first thing that popped up for us was the percentages themselves and how they don't add up to 100%. Which is vexing.
It's very disgusting.
So like understanding where those percentages are coming from is kind of important.
So maybe data ambiguity.
General. And also where those are placed within that, because it jumps from like 78% towards the bottom to like 40 at the top, 22 in the middle. And how those don't actually correspond to any spatial resolution with those, or like I don't know.
Yeah, right. They don't have to, like, there's no wrong. You should, this one is like a factor of 100.
Also, the labels don't really, the like little comments they have.
Yeah.
Sure.
And also the title, I'll throw that out there. It's the same size as the
right
information, so mm-hmm. it's like hidden.
Yeah. Very good. Three.
Yeah.
Three.
Three.
Right.
Oh my god.
To start with, there's no title, so it could be about anything.
Alright, titles are important.
So, I'm actually fascinated by this diagram. I can stare at it for a good 15 minutes. But we think that, well, so it's initially eye-catching because the background jumps out at you, but very quickly becomes extremely distracting from the information. We also think that this is a truncated snippet of a larger diagram because immediately there's a lot of information that's missing.
No labels.
No labels. And then the time between the 1980 to 1990, that one decade is a lot shorter than the decade between 1990 to 2010.
Nothing happened.
And there's
okay, so kind of like axis scaling?
Yeah, and also the range is not well defined. What year to what year it goes. Also the contrast, well there's like a this tiny, we call this word?
A little tiny bit.
The size of the
yeah.
of the words. And there's like the contrast between the background and the words.
Yeah.
What else?
We found the coins very annoying because we can't figure out how much they represent, what unit they're in.
They're pie charts, right?
Right, they're also pie charts.
How are they pie charts?
Oh, there's like these slivers.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go on.
Alright, very good.
Unnecessary.
You're doing really well here. Four. You guys ended up, there were actually some nice charts, but all the bad charts were at the beginning, and so you all ended up with bad. Anyway,
okay.
Go.
Just look at that axis.
We had it took us a while to figure out that there were actually words along the weapon.
Oh my god.
Oh,
there's
a word.
What is this for?
Is this for video games?
Yeah.
I would say,
we Google that. It's like,
it looks like there's a list of weapons.
Yeah, that's a list of weapons.
Yes. That you can't read.
And there's no real order to them, as far as we know. Well, it's hard to know, I guess. So we were talking about if those could be grouped somehow, that would be more informative. Maybe they are. Maybe, yeah. You can't tell what plane some of the points are in.
Okay.
And the y-axis starting with 2 at the bottom, which we thought was a little misleading because we were scanning for zeros.
Right. That's under like axis.
What is it showing?
Yeah, I mean the title's not helpful.
Yeah.
Weapons people use in different stages is how many kills they get for weapon.
Right, but it
seems
like they couldn't quite decide what information
yeah.
they wanted to. Try to put everything
yeah.
in as a result.
And
it's
so
then, so we were saying if you just sort of, if you could kind of integrate along the weapon axis, you could have a histogram that maybe would be
I don't have much about, I don't think I have anything about 3D plots, but can we just agree that 3D plots are the worst?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, 5.
Yeah. Ours looks really good by comparison.
I
liked the labels for each generation.
Okay.
That was very helpful.
Yeah.
So you can see vaguely where historical events took place.
Mm-hmm.
We would have preferred there be like years that you could actually see what years things took place.
Mm-hmm.
The y-axis, there's a change in y-axis, so on the right-hand side, there's a much larger, the graph itself occupies a much larger part of the y-axis than on the left-hand side, so it's hard to actually look at the individual components on the left-hand side and compare them to the right-hand side.
Where's the right-hand side?
So the right side of the graph.
Okay.
That whole part, and then so the goal is to compare the composition of each generation, right? So you can't really compare the left side because it's so small. It's just
right.
You know.
Yeah.
Assuming. Yeah. Like I have no idea if there are more black people per capita in 1925 or not.
Right. Yeah. Because it just like squeezes together here.
Yeah. And the fact that white people are on bottom means that every single one of the fine details in the other races is invisible.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's just swamped.
Right, because they're all just on
yeah.
top of this.
Yeah.
Very good.
You know a lot about visualization already.
Also, wait, is it showing birth rate per year?
Yes, that's
okay.
What we think it is. That's the only
yeah.
way it makes sense.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that would make sense.
But years aren't labeled, so. It's hard to really know.
Alright, last one, number six.
The paddle doesn't have a ball.
But this was, so maybe I should say, this was like internet searches as a function of time for that word.
Oh,
okay.
That makes a lot more sense now, because there's no like y-axis
yeah.
plot thing. So it's just percentage relative to some mean. I honestly, I thought that the color coding was kind of nice, and I like that they show the decrease by just being inverted. Clearly they're trying to draw your eye towards the gap between December and January, so that's why the time axis is not like traditional. You don't go from January to December. We had one comment where it might not be necessary to have every single day plotted because it looks like it's almost on a daily axis.
I mean, you could do some smoothing.
Yeah.
I think you might not see Valentine's Day.
That is true.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
All right.
July 3rd.
Very good. Did you like this plot on average? Or?
Yeah, it wasn't that bad. There's a couple things that would change. All
right. Okay, very good. So, you've already mentioned many of the things that we're going to talk about, and I think most of them you already kind of know at least. And so the topics that I want to talk about a bit is, not in that order actually, space, color and contrast, textures and light styles, and how to build a visual hierarchy. And before we do that, we're going to do a bit of perception. And so here I have to ask you, who of you have ever done this experiment where you had to watch a video of people playing basketball and you had to count the basketball passes? Okay, some but not all. We're gonna try to do this experiment now. I have no idea whether it'll work on the big screen or not. We'll find out.
Sorry, can you remind us to what? So we're watching basketball.
Okay, you're watching
the number of passes.
You're watching a video of a number of people playing basketball, and you have to count the passes between the people with the white shirts. Ignore the people with the black shirts. Count the passes of basketball between the people with the white shirts.
Count passes from black to white. Only passes
no.
from white to white.
No, only passes from white to white. All right. Are you ready?
There are better videos where
yeah,
more people
ones, so.
Yeah, there's also, I think the screen is maybe a bit too big.
I was just curious, could anybody not see it before people started laughing?
I know the first time I saw this, I didn't.
First time I saw it.
Yeah, the first time I saw it, I didn't see it.
So, the point of this exercise, where's my presentation? At least I know you're all awake, very good. The point of this exercise is that people have very selective attention. And your task in making a visualization is about managing that viewer's attention to the information you want them to see. So basically, don't just show them something and assume they will pay attention to the right thing. You can use people's brains to your advantage to make them see important information. And the people who have really known this for a long time are magicians, who are very good. This is Orson Welles playing a card trick. Magicians are very good at managing people's attentions until they like can do stuff in front of people's eyes, but they won't see because their attention is directed elsewhere. So human vision is not like photography. Your brain doesn't take a picture of the world where all the information is sort of has equal importance. But what you see will be managed by what goals you have and what your attention is focused on. And again, you can use that to direct people to what you want them to see in your figure. And I think one of your most sort of useful allies in this is something called pre-attentive processing, which is basically information that your brain can see without you having to expend any mental energy on it. And to do this, we're going to do another experiment. Okay, what you're going to see are figures either like this or like this. Either there is a red dot or there's no red dot. I'm going to show you 6 examples, very short, 400 milliseconds. And after each one, it'll say whether there was a red dot present or absent. And you just count how many times you saw it. All right?
See if that works.
All right. Are you ready? We've got all 6?
6.
Oh, so 6.
Yeah.
There were 6. Who got all of them correct?
Alright.
We're gonna now do the same with shape. And that looks like this.
Ooh, oh God.
Okay.
They're now going to be all the same color, but a different shape. Let's see how well that works. I'm gonna give you 6 examples again.
Yeah, I got
that. Yeah. Who got all of them?
See,
okay.
in this case, saying when it is present if you saw it is easier, but if it is not there because you're not seeing it, saying that it is absent is difficult.
So having a small the field of view on a smaller screen.
Let's show it to you. It show it to you slightly longer. This time? Yeah? So 300 millisecond is still pre-attentive. So it's still not that you could look at the image, like search through it, and then find the one that was. It is still something that your brain is automatically. Okay, last one. The last one will be a combination.
Sorry, what is the red dot?
Red circle.
What is positive?
Yeah, you're looking for the red dot.
Okay. I see.
Oh.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm not getting it.
And?
I got like one of the
I got three of them right.
Very good. Yeah. So this is no longer a pre-attentive task. Basically, to do this, you need to do a serial search through all of them. And if you're lucky, you just hit one in the time until the image vanishes. But what this basically tells you is that there's different sort of levels of hierarchy where people, where it's easy for people to distinguish things. And so you really want to make it easy for people to do this. There are sort of, there's a whole list of things that people can do pre-attentively. Here's just a few of them. Orientation is one. Density is another. This one's color, as we've seen. This one is shadow, sort of like perspective. Do you see the one that has the shadow? You know, right? Curvature works, and 3D depth as well. And there's a list of others that you can do independently. But so these give you the kind of toolbox to play with, but be mindful that not all of them are on the same level of how easy you see things. And if you mix too many of them together, all of this goes away. So just to sort of drive that home, there's a hierarchy of how easy it is to see things. Even when you mix shapes, it's still very easy for you to tell red and blue apart. And there's on the website, which is in the resources, there's another game where you can do exactly the same, just with sort of mixed features, and find for yourself. It is much harder for you to see the boundary between shapes when colors are different. Again, if you look at this for this long and this big, it's pretty easy, but I encourage you to go back to that website and try it with these combined, and you will see it's much harder. Okay. So the conclusion of all of this is choose strong visual boundaries. When you try to really separate out information in your figure, you have these shapes and these colors, which really look different to human perception. And you can use this. Things that are filled will always have a higher visual hierarchy than things that are kind of empty. But what we saw earlier is that this sort of boundary between squares and circles is actually quite a weak visual boundary. It's not very easy to see that. And here's a whole range of them where you can see these are basically hard to distinguish. So when you plot multiple sources of information, make sure you mix them up in a way that helps you parse the information. The second thing that I want to say is use color judiciously. Because it's such a strong visual identifier, that means if you color everything in different colors, then everything will have kind of the same visual weight. And so it'll be very hard for you, if there's a specific part of your plot that you really want people to get, but everything is colored, in different colors, it will be very hard for people to figure out which is the most important piece of information. To show you an example of this, so here's the original plot that these people took from a paper. It's from Nature Methods, so it's all like life sciences, and it has something to do with genes being on and off. And some of them are P and some of them are not P, whatever that means. It's not important. What you see in this plot is that all of the markers are filled, and the ones that are on just have circles around it. So reading off the report and information, in which part of the parameter space genes are on and off, is actually not that straightforward, because everything, like you look at this figure and say everything is important. Here, what people have done here is basically to just take circles in different colors, which automatically tells you something about the association between the different sources of information. And they said the on state is the most important state, so we give it the most visual weight, so that your eyes are basically always drawn to the most important parts. And only after you've encoded that information, then your brain goes, okay, what about the rest of it? And so that's the kind of thing you want to do when you visualize information. Okay. Let's talk about space. And by space, I don't mean not mean the space that we're studying, but basically this blank space you have to fill with a figure. And actually, a lot of what I'm going to say also counts for slides or posters or something. When I show you this slide, I've already sort of made a decision about how to use space. Because I said, I'm going to take a single object, in this case the writing, and I'm going to put this on this blue background, which we call negative space. And I spend a lot of time doing photography, and in photography we think about this negative space quite often. It's basically the background against which you plot. And earlier you'd shown, you've had this figure with the sort of nebula as a background, and the group said it's too busy, it's distracting. So by placing the single word in basically a sea of blue, your eyes are automatically drawn to that thing. When we talk about space, we have also talked about something called figure ground organization, which basically the question is which part of your figure is background and which part of your figure is the object. And that's really important because in terms of perception, you can play with that. And there's a whole range of these kind of plots. You probably have all seen the vase that becomes two faces. This is just another example. Your object could be the shark against the red background, or it could be the leg against the dark black background. So there's kind of different ways you can organize this. And if you make them equal in terms of a figure, unless you want to play this sort of game where you want to have perception shift. Unless you want to do that, you better be clear about which is background and which is your object. And here's another visualization example. Here's a figure of deaths in Iraq over time. And the axes are too small to see, but up there are years, and this I think is numbers. And so if you see this figure, it's fairly easy to encode that information. You kind of, up there is a zero, so you know it's going that way, and the artist has clearly decided it should look like blood flowing down or something. And you can fairly easily tell sort of where the largest number of deaths occurred. Here's now another figure, which has the same organization. And this is about gun deaths in Florida. Somehow people like to talk about with like red backgrounds or something. And so I have looked at this figure several times, and I still find it, I have to think about, when Florida enacted its Daniel Brown law, did deaths go up or down?
Up.
Yeah. But you have to think about this, because you can see this line here, and to me this line makes it look as if this was the object and this was the background. Also, despite the fact that the zero is up here, the scale for that zero is down here. So suddenly it looks like this part is actually your important bit, and this is the background, whereas it's the other way around. So be really careful about this. Yeah?
I was just wondering who published that.
Reuters. This went around Twitter a while ago. Okay, so that's what I wanted to say about space. Be careful with your backgrounds. Let's talk about color. And I know Adam mentioned this last time. When you think about color in your figures, there are sort of three major considerations, apart from like using it carefully. So how does your figure look in color, the way you just plot it? How does it look for colorblind viewers? And how does it look in grayscale? Because there's enough people who still want to sort of plot things. When you think about how things look in color, the first thing you have to realize is that color is not one thing, but color is a combination of three. Hue, luminance, and saturation. And so hue is basically going around the circle. It's just what we normally think of as color. Blue or red or yellow and orange, green, all these. You can saturate or desaturate your color, if your color is desaturated, it'll just be white or gray. And then basically luminance is a measure of brightness. If the luminance is zero, it's black. If the luminance is one, it's white. And so you can play with these three axes, and it turns out these three axes have a different effect on what your figure likes looks like overall and how you encode information. So how does it look in color? Hopefully your figure doesn't look like that, because again, nobody will be able to read it. Here's another infographic where I just think too much color, and again, you can't really tell where the important information here is. Also, it doesn't help that these red things, which you can't read, but these red things have nothing to do with that red thing over there. Because why? The other thing that you have to realize in terms of colors is that it's really hard for people to tell things apart by hue. So by this scale up here. So this encodes, according to the figure legend, metabolites in your body, and the arrows between are some form of enzymes. And so they've measured some correlation, and they decided to encode that correlation in terms of color. And now the question is, which has the highest and which has the lowest? I'd have to spend a lot of time kind of comparing to figure out. The people who wrote this paper replotted this in this way, and now this correlation is just plotted as the length of this bar in this direction. And actually they managed to get a lot more information of this plot, because each of these dots is now some measurement of enzymes, and so suddenly they had much more information that they could encode on this plot, while it's kind of much more readable than kind of this network. So hue is not a good dimension for encoding magnitude data. Luminance or saturation is much better at this than hue is. In terms of, let's actually look at another example. This is, I don't remember what this is, but it's some kind of 3D representation of some kind of magnitude something. And so in this sort of 3D figure, magnitude is only coded as hue. And so it's really difficult actually from there to really see both the details and the sort of larger scale structure. This is actually not a black and white version, but this is the same data plotted only in terms of luminance, so brightness. So values sort of on the bottom are black, and values in terms of height on the top are white. And so now you can start separating out much better some of the structure, and especially the things that you can see well are in the middle of the sort of small scale structure. Here's another plot which again uses hue, but it uses what we call a perceptually uniform color map, which I'm going to introduce in a minute. And that works much better at sort of looking at the large scale features, even though it's not as good as this and the small scale features. So in the end, what you want to do is you want to take your perceptually uniform color map and you want to combine it with some kind of luminance, and suddenly, I hope you can see that this is much easier to sort of encode than that one. And so the rule here is that luminance and these kind of like maps, luminance, this works in 2D as well, luminance is really good for sort of high spatial frequency data, so the small scales, and saturation is much better for the low spatial feature frequency. Yes? Did you have a question?
No, sorry. Okay.
All right. Have I totally confused you yet? Maybe a bit. Okay, so let's go to the second question. How does it look in grayscale? And when I talk about perceptually uniform color maps, I mean color maps that vary both in terms of hue But then also vary in terms of lightness, which is another measure for luminance, basically a mix of luminance and saturation. So what you see with these color maps is that they change in hue, but they also change from very dark colors to very light colors. Whereas many of the sort of standard color maps that you might have seen in the past, in particular the jet color map with people hate with a passion, what you can see is it starts in the sort of dark range and it ends again in the sort of dark range. And now if you take these color maps and you plot them in grayscale, what you will see is that this color map sort of goes from dark to light. Here's the jet color map again, and it goes from dark to dark. It goes from dark to light to dark. So if you plot something in this color map and then put it in grayscale, things that are blue and things that are red, which might be really different, they will just look the same. And that's clearly not something that you want. All right, third question. How does it look for colorblind viewers? This is a map of rainfall in the US, which is actually quite cleverly done. And this was plotted on a perceptually uniform color map, so it looks okay in grayscale, but it's still not a good representation of the data. Because if you put this through a colorblind simulator, this is what comes out. And what you will see is that you have these red bits here and these green bits here, and they look exactly the same. So anyone who's colorblind will not be able to read this. And usually that ends up as a recommendation that you should never use red or green. And that's mostly true, but it's only true in the sense that you shouldn't use red and green if it's the only way to distinguish information. Because here's an example of a plot that tells you how much profit people make on different categories. And even if you're not able to distinguish red and green, you can still see that you don't make much profit on like tables and bookcases and supplies, but a lot of profit on copiers. So in this case, you can see the information better with those two colors, and I would probably still prefer another color map for doing this, but it's not impossible, like in the previous example, to actually read this. The other thing that you have to be aware of is that it's not just red and green. Case in point, here is an example of a sort of standard color tablet. And what you will see if you simulate this for colorblind people is that these gray and pink actually don't look so different. And then of course the red and green don't look so different, but here the sort of purple and blue also are kind of hard to distinguish. Also there, this yellowish green and this orange don't work so well either. So it's not, you can't just say, I'm going to ignore red and green and everything else will be fine. You have to think a bit about this. Thankfully, it's actually not that hard. Most of the new standard Matplotlib color maps like Viridis are actually quite good in terms of perception. Seaborn, which we've heard about, has a palette called Colorblind. You can always use intensity, so some form of luminance or saturation to distinguish, which always works. You can use shape, of course, to distinguish. And there are sort of simulators and plugins. If you really want to be sure that it works, you just plug in your image and look at it. And I've put some resources here that you're going to get the presentation, so there's no need to frantically type. I particularly like this one. It's a plugin for your Mac, and it just colors your screen as it would look if someone's colorblind. And so that's really nice for checking what you're doing.
Sorry, which one do you pointed to quickly?
The Color Oracle.
Okay, thank you.
All right, last topic. Let's talk about visual hierarchy. We've already talked a bit about the visual hierarchy. And in order to talk about visual hierarchy, what I need to talk about a bit are Gestalt principles. Gestalt psychology is a part of psychology that started in the early 20th century. And the sort of main tenet of this sort of theory of perception is the whole is bigger than the sum of its parts. And you can see this here, you've got these sort of Pac-Man shapes, but if you put the Pac-Man shapes like this, you will also kind of automatically see this kind of triangle in here. Even though there is no triangle, there's like no triangle anywhere, you just have some Pac-Man shapes. Because they're put in this certain way, you see the triangles. And that's because there are sort of certain principles of perception, and some of them seem fairly obvious, that help you sort of make these perceptions of groups. And then one of the maybe clear ones is similarity. So things that are similar to each other will be grouped together automatically. So your brain automatically says, well, these circles belong together and these squares belong together, even though you have no other information. The same is true for proximity. And this is really important when you make sort of figures with multiple panels. Things that are closer together are assumed to have some kind of relationship, usually. So when you have basically four panels in your plot, and they all plot something completely different, make sure that the distance between them is the same. Because if you see something like this, you automatically assume that these two belong together and these two belong together. The same is true for sort of lines of things. Here again, you have proximity because these are have this proximity in this direction, and these in this direction. You automatically assume kind of that that's a line of things. So again, this is basically how your brain processes information, and you can use that to your advantage, but it can also cause a lot of distraction if your sort of figures or whatever are in certain proximity, but they're not meant to be. That causes basically confusion in the brain of the viewer, and that's basically never what you want. Connection and enclosure are again sort of two principles. These are kind of already, just based on similarity, you'll say, well, you know, these circles belong together and these squares belong together, but it's much harder to see than if you just like draw a line between them. Automatically your brain will go, well, that's a line, that's a line. Also, just putting an enclosure around things already sort of tells you that these kind of belong together in some way, that these are interesting in some way. Visual interpolation. This is actually really important for making slides or making posters. Again, there is no triangle here, nowhere. But your brain will go, there's a white triangle. It's again some kind of version of figure ground perception, but it's important to realize this. Because when you, say, make a poster, your brain will automatically do this. It will automatically sort of see the square around what you're writing, for example. So if something is kind of slightly off, then your brain goes, this is weird. This is not where things are supposed to be. And again, that causes a distraction that you would want the viewer have rather on your content than trying to parse how the different parts fit together. The last one is visual completion. If you see this and this, your brain will say that's a circle, because you just assume that the rest is hidden behind the square, but you don't know. It could just be another Pac-Man figure, it could end like this, it could be some kind of weird blob, we don't know, but that's not what your brain says. Your brain says that's a circle. And again, when you do this, when you make this kind of diagram, be sure that you sort of think about these principles in terms of where things are supposed to be. Okay, I'm actually going to skip that slide. Let's do this in practice. Let's talk again about an example how not to do visual hiring. preparing this presentation, I realized I don't have much time for what people call infographics. But where do you start reading? Where do you figure out which things really belong together? There's sort of colors all over the place. I find it really hard to read this. I mean, even though you're supposed to zoom in more, I feel like there could be more hierarchy in there that would make it easier to read different parts. Sort of a more sciencey example, if you take this plot, you have a lot of dots and you have some lines and you have some numbers and letters. And so the question is, which part is important here? What information do you want people to take away from this? And so putting everything together, you can replace this by a figure like this. And so what you see here is that people use sort of these typical Gestalt principles by saying, okay, these lines are important, and they immediately tell you something about the directions of your data. And then they use shadings and sort of enclosure to tell you where to guide your eye, which are the important parts of the figure. And then they used saturation to, you still display the rest of it, you still display the other lines, but because they have much less visual weight, that's where your brain goes to after, exactly as it's supposed to do. And so this is an example of how you can guide your viewer through where they are supposed to look as a function of time. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay, I have three more specific cases that I want to talk about. One is grids. Grids are actually really nice because they can guide your eye. But the one thing you have to be careful of when using grids is basically how wide or narrow you make your grids. In this example, basically the sort of narrower you make your spacing, the more you emphasize small changes compared to big changes. So if you don't want people to look really closely and go, oh, that change is really important, then you're probably better off not putting so much visual weight on your grid. If the important part is that this is much bigger than this, you can put a wider spacing on your grid. One good example of how to organize a lot of information visually are maps. I think everyone has probably looked at a map before. Probably
but
even
in 5 years, that maybe won't be true. Just Google Maps.
But yes. Google Maps is still only a map, and it still has to organize information. And so next time you actually look at a map, just look and think about what are the important bits. And I mean, maps are always busy, but also maps have a lot of information. And looking at how that information was organized, how they used color and weight, to sort of bring out certain things, is really interesting and can really help you understand visualization. Okay, the last part, partly because it's fun, but also because it's kind of important, I would like to talk about pie charts. I don't think astronomers, this is, I think, like one of the only legitimate uses of a pie chart I've ever seen. Pie charts, some people, especially, maybe not so much in astronomy, but in other fields, really love them. Especially, I think, in the business world. There's also this movement of people who hate them, and there's one paper in the resources which makes really good case for why you should use them from a sort of practical point of view, unless you have this kind of problem. And to do this, we're going to do a quick exercise. Can you all read the labels? Okay. You have 30 seconds to order them in sort of in how many sales there are.
What?
Order them by the size of the slice in the pie chart. You've got 30 seconds. 5 more seconds. Okay, stop. What's the most common one? Second? Which?
Pinot Grigio.
Someone said Prosecco.
I think it's Prosecco.
Okay.
Maybe it's Pinot.
Third? Fourth? Fifth?
Chardonnay.
Sixth?
Syrah.
Okay, and then last one. You're actually quite good at this, but I hope we can all agree that that's actually much easier to see.
But on the left-hand side, if you were to actually arrange them in that order.
Well, you could have arranged that in that order, but these people just didn't.
Yeah, it's still bad, I agree with that.
Right. Pie charts kind of have this advantage that you give you this kind of obvious part-to-whole relationship, except there's a thing called a stacked bar chart, which works much better for this. Because pie charts are actually quite terrible for comparing information for two reasons. And that's, we're really bad at judging area and angles. And it turns out people have done studies about this, and people consistently underestimate area in this kind of pie chart, and they consistently, I think, also underestimate angles. So we're really not good at this, which makes pie charts kind of a double-edged sword, especially if you have to compare information quickly. Here's my last example. This is top 10 salaries at Google. And now the two questions is which role has the largest range and which has the largest salary?
Lead software engineer, but I had to get that from my university.
Anyone want to shout in answers?
I think the largest range is directors.
Yeah.
Okay. And then the largest salary.
Software and lead software.
Yeah. But it took me like a while to stare at this and realize, okay, this is not actually a pie chart because it starts at the lowest salary and then kind of goes around to the highest and then it's all sort of plotted on top of each other. And I actually had to read a lot of numbers to figure out what's going on.
And no one's looked at making 241K even though that number is up there.
And so again, you could just make that plot, right? And immediately you kind of see that information. If you had some kind of other information you wanted to put in there, you could put in like the bars in different shades, or maybe actually directors are important, so you put them in red and everything else in gray, or something like that. Okay. Before I go on to what you have to do, are there any questions? Yeah?
Would you mind for just a second, can you go back to your, it seems like you had like a best practices slide, or?
Did I?
You mentioned Viridis and some other things on that slide.
Oh, that was just for color. That was like best practices for color.
Okay. Mainly, I was going to ask, as we go home and we start making our own figures for papers, what would you recommend? Okay, so use Viridis. That's one thing. What would you recommend, just sort of as the process of doing that? This is a very vague and incredibly open-ended question.
So the process that I would go through is, first of all, ask yourself, what do I want the reader to take away from this figure? And sort of immediately following up from that would be the question, what's the most important piece of information? Because I see a lot of figures where everything has the same visual weight, and suddenly it's really hard to figure out what's going on. So what I would do, actually, the problem is we're scientists, so all of our information is incredibly important to us, and we would like to put it all in this one plot, but that's not actually helpful in conveying what you want to do. So usually when you put a plot in your paper or on your slide, you want the reader one sort of message, maybe the title of your figure. That's the thing you want them to take away from it. So that's the thing you want people, that you want to have the most visual weight. And then I would start designing around that and say, okay, so I need to plot this specific line that needs to be thicker and it needs to be blue. All the other lines, how important are they? Is there again some kind of hierarchy between those lines? Yes or no? Let's say I had done a clustering like Matthew showed earlier, and there was one specific cluster that was really important. I would, for example, give that a high saturation, and then maybe the other clusters I would still give some kind of color, but maybe I would plot them with like alpha 0.5 so that they're much fainter. Or maybe I would make that one important cluster red, and all the other clusters I would make black, but give them different shapes so that they're still distinguishable, but that your eye is guided toward what the most important information is. And then I would go further and sort of try to strip out everything that you don't need to do that kind of to answer that question. And then you go to considerations. When I pick color, how does it look? Is there too much color? Is that color that I have colorblind friendly? How does it look in grayscale? And then sort of answer these questions. Does that answer your question? Sort of?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I'll ask a follow on as well. So we saw many examples of figures that did not properly convey information. There weren't an equal number, I'll say, or anywhere close, of figures that do a great job of that. So do you have a recommendation for a place to go to just perhaps find inspiration for making great figures? Maybe it was one of your references too.
Yeah, I do have a few references. So if you just search for good visualizations, you find much, much more bad visualizations. There's like this one here, it's called this.wtf, and it just like collects terrible visualizations. Actually, one of my favorite ones is, no, maybe it's not on here, is this page called Information is Beautiful. No,
it's your last tab.
Oh, there. I quite like Information is Beautiful. It's quite good at taking a lot of information and putting it into like things that are visually interesting, but also kind of like still visible. There is at the very end of my talk, there's like a whole list of various references that I use or that other people used. There is a whole range of Nature Methods articles that if you have access to Nature, you can access, I hope via your institution you do. I think I even managed to do without the other day. But they have a lot of In those, it's like one page. It's just one page of some specific topic, and there's like 30 of them. But usually they have one bad example and then how to change it to a nicer example, which is nice. There's a bunch of papers just about how to do good visualization, and some of them are quite old. But really, I would just like, when you see a figure, I would just try to ask yourself, what do you like about it, what do you not like about it? When you see a visualization in a newspaper or on the New York Times, the New York Times usually has good visualizations as well, because they have a whole dedicated department for that. Oh, the website for D3JS, I think, is probably a good, like,
just as a quick intro to everyone, so D3JS is an incredibly, incredibly powerful plotting package, but it is not high level like Python. So
no,
it is Python. You have to go in and do everything you want to do. You
JavaScript.
Essentially have to program it in JavaScript, but you can make beautiful looking things.
But
like
the like just for looking at sort of examples of nice figures, actually just this like gallery is quite nice.
So there's another question, it looks like.
Not really a question, but there is a Python package that only generates D3JS from the data.
Oh, okay.
I don't remember the name, but it's really easy to use.
Okay.
The same thing, and the same, and what I would also mention is that R has fantastic package called ggplot, which uses the grammar of graphics. You can do layered graphics. And matplotlib has a style called ggplot. So you may want to try that too. So you can simply use that style in matplotlib.
All right, so I'll ask, are there any further questions for Daniela? Okay, we can stop the recording.
I have to do my...
Yeah, but you can stop your screen recording too right now.
Okay.